Amen. And so all I'm saying is, first of all, he had to have an encounter with Jesus before he could go from empty to full. And I'm talking to somebody in here. I ain't just talking about the miracle of resources and blessings and finances and money and problems and healings and some of the other things that we're dealing with. But I want you to know that he had to go through a season of emptiness before he could appreciate when Jesus came into his experience. And there was an encounter with the Messiah. What I want you to know is that when his boat was full, when it was full of fish, there was no room for Jesus. If he had met Jesus with a full boat, he wouldn't have had any room for Jesus to step into the boat. So he had to go through a season of emptiness before Jesus could fill his boat according to his will. One of the things I talked about this morning is that I spent 20 years in the military, spent 20 years in the United States Air Force. And one of the things that happened initially when I got in the Air Force, my career just took off. Everything was working right. Everything was going smoothly. I was making rank on time like I was supposed to, matter of fact, in ahead of time. But I got toward the end of my career when my career should have gone all the way to the top and I should have gone all the way up. All of a sudden, everything came up empty. No matter how hard I worked, people didn't appreciate it. No matter how much education I got, it didn't seem to help me move up the ladder like I was supposed to. And so all of a sudden, what had been full became very empty. And so I started getting, you know how we do when we're on a job and folks don't appreciate us and we see other folks who are less qualified. All of a sudden, next thing you know, they over us and they're moving up. First thing we say, they don't like me. Now I started singing the blues. I said, they don't like me. That's why I can't understand why other folks are getting blessings and I'm not getting anything. They must not like me. Are y'all gonna pray with me? And then you know, sometimes when that ain't good enough, we start looking at other reasons why things ain't opening up and things aren't filling up like they ought to. Come on, somebody.
Yes,
you've been there before. When you see folks who look differently than you, they're going up and down the ladder, and you can't seem to get one promotion. Come on, somebody.
Yes,
and we start thinking there's some other things why folks don't want to give me what's coming to me. But as I began to deal with it, the Lord kept dealing with me. And one of the things that happened was, as I turned away from the world and from the military and started looking at what God would open up and the doors that he would extend to me and the blessings that he would give to me, I found out that God put a ceiling on my progression. God put a top on my possession in the military because he didn't want me to go to the next level. He didn't want me to be filled by the military and by the government. He had another way he wanted to fill me. Are y'all praying with me? Amen. And what I found out was is that God put a ceiling over there so he can open up a door over here. And so when I got out of the military, he filled me in other ways. He filled me with duties and he filled me with ministry and he filled me with a flock. Come on, somebody. So that I could have another door open that he would fill me according to his will. But I first had to have an encounter with Jesus. And that encounter with Jesus came after a season of emptiness. Are y'all praying with me? And what are you talking about, preacher? Well, all of us have an encounter with Jesus. Sometimes we don't move on the first encounter. Are y'all praying with me? Because most of us, and a lot of us been in church a long time, we try to act like we always had it together. But we ain't always have it together. And we didn't move the first time we encountered Jesus. And Peter is no different. The Bible tells us in the fourth chapter of the book of Luke that he had already met Jesus two times already. He had already encountered him. I told you to keep your Bible open. I'm ready. He had already encountered him two times. He encountered him at the church. Because the Bible says that in Galilee of Capernaum, that Jesus went to the synagogue and he healed a man who had a demon. Now you got to know, if you're a Bible reader, that Peter is from Galilee of Capernaum. Right. Y'all going to hear me in a minute. Right. And Peter was going to the church that Jesus went to heal the man who was demon possessed.
Right.
And so he had met Jesus at church.
Yeah.
But he didn't start following Jesus
right.
until he had an empty boat. Y'all gonna hear me in a minute.
Yeah.
He met Jesus at church, but that wasn't good enough because God knows that many of us need more than one encounter with Jesus.
Yeah.
If y'all like me, you would have several encounters before you started doing what God wanted you to do.
Yeah.
Oh, y'all gonna hear me in a minute.
Yeah.
Some of us need two times. Well, Peter is no different. He had a second occasion when he encountered Jesus in the same fourth chapter of the book of Luke. The Bible says that his mother-in-law had a fever.
That's right.
And when his mother-in-law had a fever, Jesus went in that hot situation at the house.
Yes.
Because you know sometimes things can get heated at the house.
All right.
And so Jesus went to the house, healed his mother-in-law, and she got out and started serving the devil here in a minute. But he still didn't follow Jesus. It wasn't until he had gone through a season of emptiness, toiling all night on the boat with no fish to show for it or to produce in his experience. And the Bible said, after Jesus filled his boat, he dropped everything and followed Jesus. And I don't know about you, but sometimes it takes three times. Sometimes it takes four times. He don't give you one chance sometimes. Sometimes he give you five. But whatever you need, sometimes you might have to go through some emptiness for him in order to fill the need that you have. I wish I had a witness. It matters. Somebody's going through some empty stuff right now. You're going to an empty house when you go home. I wish I had a witness. Somebody sleeping double in a single in a double bed, empty. I wish I had a witness in here. Somebody on tomorrow morning, everybody else gonna get up and go to work, but you ain't got no work to go to. Y'all gonna hear me in a minute. Somebody gonna go to the ATM after this, and you gonna get some money so you can go over to the Golden Corral and get you something to eat. But somebody's got an ATM card, but they ain't got no money in the account. Empty. Y'all gonna hear me in a minute. But I want you to know that however your empty situation is, Jesus is able to fill your spirit. He's able to take you from empty to full. I can't take too long. Matter of fact, I'm going to leave you here. One of the things I want to share with you is that Paul, the Bible says that Peter went from a situation of emptiness to fullness.
Yeah.
And it was a miracle that brought physical blessings to Peter. Because
yeah.
he had an empty boat, but he ended up with a boat full of fish.
Yeah.
And all of his friends who was fishing had fish too.
Yes, sir.
Y'all gonna hear me in a minute.
Yes, sir.
So he went from emptiness to being filled.
Yeah.
But it was a physical blessing.
Yeah.
But the miracle of the physical blessing was just a mechanism in order to get Peter to see who Jesus really is. And once he saw who Jesus really is, then the Bible said he left the miracle of the fish,
yes, sir.
And the boat,
yes, sir.
And the livelihood, and the word. Come on, somebody. And follow Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Now, what does that tell us? Well, preacher, first of all, it tells us that, look, I don't care what miracle Jesus does in your life. I don't care if you got cancer today and then tomorrow you go to the doctor and he heals you in this service and he heals you and all of your cancer is gone. I want you to know that that's a miracle. Are y'all praying with me? That's a miracle. But one of the things I wanted you to know is that physical blessings and miracles are only temporary. They're only temporary. I don't care how many times your body gets healed. One of these days, you gonna die. You ain't gonna pass, you gonna die. You ain't gonna pass away. You're physically going to die. That's the reality of things. Unless Jesus comes back and changes you before you die, you're going to die. I don't care what the doctors do. I don't care how successful the surgery is. I don't care how good the medication is you're taking. One of these days, you're gonna die. Are y'all praying with me? I don't care if all of a sudden you can't pay your bills and then tomorrow you win the lottery. Come on, somebody. You ain't gonna act like you don't play. I know you play. Because the lottery said you can't win if you don't play. You might as well say wink, amen. I don't care if you hit the lottery tomorrow. One of these days, amen, you're gonna have to leave the lottery, the bank account, the money, the house, and everything else you buy with it to folks who may not even take care of it once you're gone. Because it's temporary. But one of the things about it is that when God does a miracle in your heart and in your experience, it helps you to know that he is God. And then when you know he's God, it ought to help you to respond in kind, to follow him and to do what he says. Look at Peter said. The Bible says that Peter had an encounter. He obeyed Jesus. Don't forget that. He told him to go out into the deep. And he obeyed. He said, throw your net on this side. He said, well, Lord, we've been toiling all night, but at your word, I'm going to do what you say. And the Bible says he obeyed God, and God blessed him with a miracle. Are y'all praying with me?